Anyway, so that's kind of piece one of all of this. Piece two is there's a crisis of legitimacy going on in the Hong Kong system, in the Chinese system, in the Shanghai system, everywhere in the Chinese system. Oh, sorry, I've had too much coffee. Where was I?
I'm Nathan Rich, aka 火锅大王. In the last video, we were introduced to a walking parody of an expert named Peter Zion. We watched as he spread his bizarre, easily falsified ramblings about COVID vaccines in China, and we witnessed people on the internet discussing his allergy to facts. The weird virtue signal video he released really has two sections. The first one we cover. It was a bunch of lies and confusion. Today, let's go over the second part of the video, which further evidences his utter lack of understanding of China. You may be inclined to search for Peter on the internet. Be very careful doing so, because nearly everything bearing his name is littered with comments of people who actually understand what research is and how facts work. He is constantly being called out for his abuse of the truth, and you'll definitely want to avoid this website, Next Big Future, which has relatively long articles picking apart and refuting Peter's claims. And here's his Ask Me Anything thread. Let's see. What's the top question? Can you expand on the challenges Greece faces? His answer? Greece imports 80% of its food and 100% of its energy. The only reason Greece was even created as a nation-state is back in the 1800s, the Brits invented modern Greek nationalism as a means of destabilizing the Ottoman Empire. And a commenter immediately responds with, "The first sentence might contain false statistics. All credible sources, such as the World Bank, state that Greece has recently been importing around 61 to 64% of its energy, while also exporting some. And the next sentences contain wild and dismissive perspectives on history which sound awfully a lot like propaganda." Let's take a look at how he describes himself on his website. Peter Zeihan is an expert in geopolitics, the study of how place impacts financial, economic, cultural, political, and military developments. He presents customized executive briefings, blah, blah, blah. According to something called Big Speak, you can hire Peter Zeihan to speak at your event for between $20,000 and $30,000, including for subjects such as A World Without China, Three Pillars Support Modern China's Success, Global Trade, Political Unity, and Easy Money. Yeah, if there's three pillars to be described about China's success, it's these. Global trade, political unity, and easy money. China has managed to shake 2,000 years of war and occupation. Occupation for 2,000 years. Jesus, this is really going to be a shock to all the Chinese people who have no idea what you're talking about. I mean, even if you consider the Yuan Dynasty occupation, I mean, do you think that was 2,000 years ago? None of these pillars can stand without American assistance. Yes, if there's one thing to be learned from geopolitical experts like Peter, it's that political unity cannot exist in China without American assistance. Political unity in the party the United States has maintained something of a proxy war against for around 80 years. Thank you, America, for allowing China to experience relative unity for so long. And thank you, Peter, for showing the world this basic truth. Peter has, we will establish by the end of this video series, no meaningful understanding of modern Chinese history, no deep grasp of the forces in motion in China, and no factual basis on which to form his bizarre theories. Let's get right back into it. The action starts immediately.
Chairman Xi has...
Xi? You know he's not French, right? Chinese doesn't have that sound.
Chairman Xi has instituted a cult of personality that is far more extreme than anything that any of the Chinese leaders before him have instituted. And that includes the emperors of old as well as Mao himself.
Do I actually have to comment on this? Are you serious?
He has executed or imprisoned or intimidated into silence or exiled everyone within the system who has a degree of intelligence or policy creativity, and now it is just him by himself.
Yes, that makes perfect sense. Even though there's no evidence of this, and even a cursory mental glance at these claims renders them as ridiculous, it just makes sense. The president of China has purged all intelligent and creative people in the at least 200 million who are the Communist Party, the government, the Communist Youth League, and all the other parts of the system you mentioned. That's right. Ukrainian Ambassador Peter Zhang has just proven that a large portion of Chinese people are stupid. And that's because someone named Xi, because Peter didn't actually give a reason.
And that makes it impossible for the ship of state to turn. And so we're seeing worse and worse decisions coming out of Beijing because there's no longer is there anyone in the system who will tell Xi what's going on. Not that they won't tell him bad news. They won't tell him any news because they don't know how he's going to react. And he has literally shot the messenger so many times that nobody else wants the job.
I don't know how to tell you this, Peter. But the president goes around interfacing with the public, speaking at conventions, rallying support, and directing his part of the government all the time. This picture you're drawing of someone totally unaware of the unnamed realities around him doesn't seem to jive with the evidence at hand. And what does any of this have to do with COVID?
How does that apply to COVID?
Yeah, that's what I said. What does it have to do with COVID?
How does that apply to COVID? Well, it starts with the Ukraine war.
Of course it does. Of course it does.
The Ukraine war is not going well for the Chinese.
Peter then goes on to make a point that the war in Ukraine is reducing exports from Russia to China. It's a very long-winded and rambling speech.
The infrastructure that is required to bring Russian export to China was operating at maximum capacity before the war began.
Okay, so you're saying that Russian imports to China have gone down, and you're explaining why, but...
The production side of things within Russia, especially in eastern Siberia, where the terrain is much more rugged and the geology much more complex.
Hang on.
The production there is dependent upon foreign companies being operating.
Peter!
Shell and Exxon from the super majors, or Baker Hughes and Schlumberger and services firms. And so the Russians were already sending the Chinese economic from the east. They also had to come from
Peter,
the west.
Peter!
So
So, the Chinese are arguably, after the Ukrainians of course, the biggest losers from the Ukraine war so far.
Peter, finally. That was a really long speech, but you didn't need to make it, because you're wrong. I could have saved you all that time. China's imports from Russia surged to new high, up 56.6% from a year earlier and 13.3% above March. See? Dude, just ask me next time, or search in an internet search engine. It was a good try, but you were completely wrong.
The Chinese system cannot adapt to changing circumstances, all of which have turned against the state. So the only remaining tool that China has, that Xi has, to maintain his power and his control over the population is health. And so every time we get a case outbreak in China, the state has no choice but to do a complete zero tolerance lockdown because they don't dare open.
Wow, that was a bad take. I mean, forget about the fact that it's all based on falsities. Let's just pretend that your portrayal of the facts was accurate. It's still not a realistic take in almost any situation. One person has isolated himself so much that he's unaware of what's going on, even though he talks about the issues publicly. Because of him, a large portion of Chinese people are stupid. And because China's importing Russian goods so much more than last year, that means China has to do COVID lockdowns. That's the theory he's just put forward as plausible.
Remember, the Chinese vaccine doesn't work very well at all.
No vaccines work very well if we make up statistics and don't understand the ones that exist. Then Peter obliviously makes a case for lockdowns in China.
Antibodies or the vaccine, but in China they have neither.
Wrong.
Which means that if there was an outbreak like the United States had in, say, January with Omicron, you are literally talking about millions of Chinese dying in a very short period of time.
Well then, I guess China should prevent that from happening within reason. The longer it delays the inevitable, the less deaths we can expect. The death rate overall has gone down literally since this lockdown began. I covered this before, but basically the longer you can delay a disease, the less people will die from it, generally speaking. Now, don't get me wrong, China will not achieve permanent zero COVID, and anyone who says they will is not being realistic. Zero COVID is a delay policy, and so far it's working at great cost to delay and prevent deaths. You know what? No. I'm not going to allow you to pretend that the reason the government locks things down is because they want power. I'm so absolutely sick of this cartoon-level assessment. It's just pathetic. I'm going to tell you the truth now, Peter, even though I know you won't get it. You see, this touches on a side of China no one outside it sees clearly, and I see just a blurry shape. There is a current running through the population here, in swaths. It's a power of and demand of vengeance and justice and penance. It moves in waves and changes directions quickly. But when it strikes, it's fierce. China's history is jam-packed with its effects. It's a quiet hum inside the collected Chinese psyche. Many can feel it, but usually can't explain it or even express the feeling. But history shows it again and again. Perhaps it's the real historical dragon. It's this energy, as one of its side effects, that keeps the Chinese government in check. It's an awesome force implanted deep in this culture. It distances Chinese from others, but collectively binds them to themselves. Put simply, so that even a China expert like you could understand, the reason the government is running lockdowns on the people is because if they didn't, the people would demand that they did. If China, after all this struggling and Wuhan lockdown and sacrifice and we gotta all stand up together against COVID and all that, if they just randomly told everyone, oh, screw it, whatever, just like the US did, that I know this is really hard to understand for you, and I know a lot of my viewers won't understand or agree, but I don't care. I don't need to be popular. But if China actually did that, they would risk losing the support of the entire country. How dare they put up such a long and powerful fight with the support and contribution of the citizens and then just give it up without so much as a whimper? Are you starting to understand? That streak, that passionate, powerful undercurrent would engage and destroy everything in its path. So here's a take that you might disagree with, but at least it's thought out. China is doing these lockdowns because they save lives. Not just the lives of the people affected by the virus, but the lives of everyone in China. And the next step that they'll take after this large wave of lockdowns is they will start to transition into the new norm phase as gracefully as possible. They will have the successes of battle under their belt, and the country will know just how many lives were saved. But they are just as aware as anyone else, you can't do this to Shanghai twice. You can do it once because it has to be done, but twice? No. Everyone knows it. I'm just the only one saying it. So China will evolve and it will persist. It always does. And people like you will come up with some other grade school level analysis like you always do. Anyway, then he says,
the Chinese, for internal reasons, for legitimacy reasons, no longer see participating in international manufacturing supply chains as a key to their own success. It's a nice to have, but they don't have to have it. Central control is far more important.
Oh, definitely. Jesus, 100 times as important. Hell, I don't care what the Chinese see as more important. Central control or manufacturing jobs. I'm telling you directly, it's central control. It's hundreds of millions of lives more important than manufacturing jobs. Every single day, I research China's history from the 1800s and on. Every single day, I read about more deaths caused by lack of strong central control. Every single day. So, yeah, if there were Chinese who previously thought manufacturing was more consequential than a strong central government, they're wrong. Let me be the first to tell them.
And so if you have not started moving your stuff out of China yet, it may well be too late, because it will never get better than it is right now.
Ooh, scary. Peter's just another doomsday forecaster, and I'll go over that in the next video. That's when I'll finally actually get into his overall view of China and his predictions. Spoiler alert, he doesn't understand China. His virtue signaling, phony expertise may fool some people out there, but it doesn't fool me and my supporters. I'm really not as interested in current politics as I am in history, but even I have to pay attention when someone like him comes around setting world records for the amount of stupid crammed into one video. And believe it or not, this was all just a warm-up. Anyway, until next time, thanks everybody. 谢谢.
This is really bad. Peter!